I've made a few posts about the Digi Dock over the last few months, and I thought it would be a good time to finally release a showcase of the device along with an interview that I did with the creator a few weeks ago. As you may or may not already be aware, the Digi Dock is a device that was engineered with upgradability in mind. On the back of the case, you can see there are several sets of Allen key screws around the entire back plate. These screws hold the internal components like the batteries and SBCs in place on a track that makes servicing everything inside this unit fairly easy. If we take a look at the underside, one of the interesting things that I like about the dock is the fact that it supports two forms of USB charging ports. This basically means that you're bound to be able to charge this device wherever you are if you happen to forget your own cables. I also find it interesting that the majority of the printing on this device is in English, even though this was originally intended for Chinese users. In the middle of this panel, you'll find the first air vent that is situated right next to a very small heat exhaust pipe connected to the CPU on the SBC inside this device. The top side of this holds another interesting design choice on this case, as the unit only comes with a single set of large shoulder buttons. These are your L1 and R1 keys, but you have the ability to use L2 and R2 by pressing the key in from the side. In both cases, you'll hear an audible click when you press the key. I'm not sure these will work in absolutely every case imaginable, but I didn't have any issues using these as N64 keys or as L2, R2 keys in PS1. On the right side, you'll find the LED activity light and two sets of USB ports. So far, I've only used these ports with flash drives, but they should have the same support that you'd get from plugging directly into the board inside the dock. The other side of this has actually gone through some changes over the development of this product, as you'll see later in this video, and it looks poised to change in the next iteration again. This current version displays battery charge through a set of four LED lights that shine for each quarter of a charge that you have. I believe the next version of this dock will come with a mini LCD screen powered by an Arduino to give you a digital readout of your battery charge. Near this, you have a full-size HDMI out port that is controlled via a screen switcher icon on the front panel. Now, let's talk about the main controls. I've actually gone through and completely swapped out all of the buttons that you see here to their black variants. This case comes with a set of red and blue keys that I wasn't really fond of, but the box does include a set of black keys, and I went out and swapped all of these when I did my first teardown of the dock. Above the right stereo speaker, you'll also see that this dock is sporting a low-profile joystick that comes directly from the original PlayStation Portable. There are five main keys on the center of the device, with the two on the right controlling the screen itself. The center key powers on and off the dock, and to the left, there are two volume keys that control the dual stereo speakers. The left side of the dock is probably my favorite, and I really like the choices that were made here. You'll hear later from the developer of the dock himself, but the D-pad and other keys that went into this were made specifically for the dock, and they do work well. It's probably already obvious to many of you where this analog stick came from, and if you're familiar with that, then you already have a good idea of how it works in this implementation. This stick kind of goes with the philosophy behind most of the dock, in that if you're going to have a large device, you may as well make good use of that extra space with good components. Beyond supporting L3, I wanted to make sure that this functions as a real joystick, and one of the best ways to show that off with the board that comes with this is to fire up a copy of Mario 64 to check the input. As you can see, the stick correctly responds to input in the way that you'd expect, especially if you grew up playing this game on official N64 hardware. As I've said before, I've actually already featured this device in a few different places, and I had planned on already having a full review for this device out by now, but I've been waiting for a component that I need to be able to interface the screen in the dock with my modified Pi 4 board. The base configuration of this device is powered by a 3B Plus, which is great, but I already have a bunch of 3B handhelds, and I really would like to start growing my Pi 4 collection, even if I have to do the upgrades myself. As it currently stands, this device can interface with pretty much anything that you throw at it, but it's wired internally for mini HDMI out of the box. The HDMI micro PCB that I need is currently still being manufactured. When that PCB is finally produced in the next month or so, I'll use that opportunity to do a full proper review of this device by featuring the upgrade process, since that's the real reason why I think anyone would buy this in the first place. As many of you probably already know, China bans most forms of Western social media, so in the same way that I did with my first ZPG video, I wanted to give the creator of the Digi Dock the opportunity to talk directly to all of you, and I hope that through his words, you can get a deeper understanding of the work that went into this project. You will see subtitles at the bottom of your screen hard-coded into this video, but if you don't speak English, you can also turn on YouTube translations, which should work well since I've supplied the subtitles directly to this video. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this look at the Digi Dock. If you have any other questions, you can leave them below, or you can join the Discord linked in the description box below. I have a Digi Dock channel in there that you can follow along with any of the developments for this handheld.
2018年3月份的时候，自己得到一块说明派，我本身并不懂这些编程呀，本身是一名工程师，土建的工程师。 当时拿到这个说明派板子以后，我在想它可以用来做什么。玩过一段时间以后，栓完各种镜像，然后我就想给它做一游戏系统，很行。然后我就想给它做一台游戏机吧，我就开始参考各种游戏机的这个布局，然后就做了一个金属外壳，这样就从网上买各种套件，买各种东西，各种试。这里边走了好多弯路，通过半年的时间，我把第一代这个机子做出来。做出来以后，给一些朋友去看，然后他们比较喜欢这个造型跟这个材质各方面这个5寸的这个大屏幕。这时候我就在想。 因为这个机子本身它是空间是很大的，为什么不给它兼容更多的这个板子呢？因为目前市场上有好多板子跟树莓派的这个板子的布局是一样的，但是最后这些适配都是成功的。第一代机到第三代机其实是没有肩键的。 但是通过朋友们强烈的建议以后，我用了好长时间，然后就设计自己设计出一个就是双方向这样一个肩键，通过 3D 打印，然后自己 3D 打印这个精度不够，又去找大工业级的 3D 打印去调整，去修改，但是目前的话还是感觉有好多这个可以升级的地方。实质键这个东西从一开始就一直在困扰着我，最后就是通过无数次的这个开模调整，达到了一个比较理想的状态。电池方面的话，我当时也是选用了几个厂家的电池，都是不太好，安全性不太好，然后性能也不太好。稳定性也不太好，虽然说便宜，但是后来我就是取消掉了他们家的这些这个方案。 选用了索尼原装电芯，这个电池的话比较好，还比较安全，但是双保护。然后我想说的是什么？就是说玩这些掌机的人，一般都是咱们80后、70后、80后，对于那个时代会有一个比较深刻的一个怀念。当时小的时候买一台 GBA、 GBC， 这是一件非常奢侈的事情，但是长大以后有钱了，也必须买这个东西，但是买上了又不玩。 这样的话，因为大家就是目前对这个数码产品日益增高的这个需求，还有一些厂家做出来的产品就是一成不变的这样一个产品，所以我想出这样一个办法去为就是这群朋友来服务。这个产品最大的一个特点呢是什么？就是硬件可以无限升级，也就是说我现在已经适配到的一些这个板子 PCB 核心。 我希望大家真正的去了解这个一台机子，因为我本身有好多掌机，他们都在吃灰，但是我不希望 N 家去吃灰，我希望就是大家秉承一个折腾不停的玩下去这样一个态度，去无尽的去折腾 N 家。N 家目前的这个版本的话，属于国内的一个先行版本，但是后期版本的话，我会对它进行一个比较深度的升级，后期的话就是。 比较国际化的一个版本的话，会是一个很轻松去适配各种系统，很轻松的去适配各种核心，提供更简单、更安全、更高效的拆机装机的方式。当时我就在想，我如果能用最好的东西，我绝对不会用更好的东西，我只针对喜欢这个东西的人去做一个大家喜欢的事情，做一个大家喜欢的产品，然后让大家更开心。 我的目的只是这样，然后非常感谢国际上的一些朋友，因为我这个也没有跟国际直接对话，不同的需求，目前就是这样子。 谢谢大家，再次感谢大家。